Chapter 1 of King and Parliament, A.D. 1603 to 1714. King and Parliament, A.D. 1603 to 1714, by George Henry Wakeling. Introduction. The Middle Ages had ended in England amid the storm and stress of the Wars of the Roses. Wearied out by 30 years of bloodshed on the battlefield and the scaffold, the English nation threw itself at the feet of Henry VII and craved of him naught but strong governance and the end of anarchy. It was on these terms that he and his progeny ruled England. But the Tudors had a shrewd perception of the truth that Englishmen are more easily led than driven. They were tyrannical to many individuals who resisted their will in things secular or religious, but to the majority they represented that majesty and security which we now describe as the state. For while they maintained strict law and order in the land, as is the first duty of every government, they studiously avoided collisions with the prejudices and feelings of the nation. The result was that during the 16th century Englishmen developed a new spirit. It was not quite a spirit of liberty. We are accustomed nowadays to a freedom in our actions and opinions which was quite unknown then. If a man spoke or wrote, or even thought differently from his fellows in Tudor times, he was suspected of disloyalty. There had been so much anarchy and division during the civil wars of the previous century that an absence of disagreement was felt to be the all-important thing. The king and his government must be obeyed without criticism. Religion was not, as now, a matter for each man to choose for himself without interference. The government could not afford to let men obey their own consciences. A Roman Catholic was an enemy of the nation because he believed in the Pope's authority rather than in the king's. A Puritan was suspected of disloyalty because he placed his own ideas before the law of the land. No one could be loyal both to Pope and king. Many had to choose between law and conscience. The slightest criticism of any matter in church or state was considered the forerunner of rebellion. If the Tudors gave England peace and order, they expected in return unquestioning obedience. The nation was to be one in thought and belief, for only so could it be one in action. It was thus that Englishmen learned to feel that they were one, and the 16th century gave us a national spirit. It was shown in many ways. Men like Raleigh felt sure that nature intended Englishmen to fight Spaniards. Men like Richard Grenville expressed their joy that they never turned their backs on Don or Devil yet. Shakespeare transplanted into the tale of the Lancastrian reigns a fire and a patriotism which really belonged to his own day. But the real source of this spirit was the change in religion. The Reformation had a profound effect upon England as a nation and upon the separate individuals who composed it. It taught Englishmen to believe in their independence and freedom from the interference of the Bishop of Rome. This was at the bottom of the great national feeling of which we have spoken. But men also learnt that since they were responsible to God for their own acts and words, they must learn to think for themselves. This was an entirely different feeling. It made each man believe in himself. It may be called the personal spirit. Now the Tudors wished to have the national spirit without this personal one. The first would help to secure reverence for their government, for men would see in the monarch the embodiment of that free, orderly nation which was for the future to depend upon itself. But the second was considered dangerous. It might lead men to question the sovereign's right to decide religion, as it had led them to question the Pope's right. Now this is exactly what happened. This personal spirit led men into a new religious belief. When, in the latter half of the 16th century, the Church of England, as established by law in Elizabeth's day, failed to satisfy some earnest thinkers, they adopted the extreme opinions of the continental Protestants. This new religious force was called in derision Puritanism. the men who held it wished to purify the church of all that reminded them of a hated popish past, of bishops, of ceremonies and ritual, even of sacraments. Elizabeth, while relaxing wherever possible the bonds of discipline, yet refused to allow to individual consciences any departure from the church system she had established, either in the direction of Roman Catholicism or of the advanced Protestantism of the continent. So the Puritans were punished for not conforming to the national church, no less than were the Roman Catholics. Some obeyed and accepted the prayer book and episcopacy. Others shook the dust of England from their feet and went abroad. Thus there were two new spirits or forces in the land which must some day become antagonistic to each other, the national and the personal spirit. The Tudor government had set itself to use the first and curb the second. At the beginning of the 17th century, therefore, England needed a great man, and there was a great work for him to do. When a nation becomes strong and united, the time for absolute government is past. A monarch may act for a people when they are disunited, and discipline them when they quarrel, but he must act with them when they have learned the lesson of unity. They will then require some share in their own government, some right to advise or choose. They will refuse to be told what they are to do and believe, as if they were still unable to act and think for themselves. It is always a slow movement from the one form of government to the other, and at the crisis it needs a man who possesses the nation's confidence to lead it steadily along the path of toleration and self-government. Such a leader must believe in the nation, no less than in himself. The crisis had now arrived, and unfortunately for England, the Stuart kings, who now sat upon the throne of the Tudors, were quite unfitted for the task. They believed in themselves and not in the nation. They thought they had a personal mission to govern, and consequently treated opposition and criticism as impudence and ignorance. No doubt they had a good deal of both to encounter, but the new rulers were unable to discern that underneath the opposition and prejudices there lay that spirit which has been the making of all great nations. James I and Charles I wished to work on Tudor principles and failed to understand that they had to deal with a people which had already spent a sufficient number of years in the nursery. Nor were these kings prepared to work with the nation and take it as it was. They believed they possessed a divine hereditary right, a right endorsed by their own wisdom and abilities, sanctioned by the personal power allowed to past kings, and upheld by their family tree. They did not comprehend that the sovereign power which all efficient governments must possess will only be respected by those who approve its work and can understand its methods. So they drew a line between themselves and the nation, and thus destroyed that mutual understanding which had supported the Tudor government. While the tyrant, Henry VIII, had often taken his parliaments into his confidence, King James or King Charles were always careful to remind the two houses that they and their sovereign could never treat as equals. Thus the union of king and people which the Tudors had fostered, the Stuarts neglected. But the nation had learned the lesson and believed in it. When the good-natured laziness of James I and the conceit of his son Charles allowed the national feeling to be wounded by arrogant Spanish ambassadors and subservient royal chaplains, resistance was aroused at once. In contemning the national spirit, these kings aroused the personal one, the Puritan one. Roman Catholicism was still to most Englishmen the evil one in disguise, and when the Stuarts refused to see it in that light, yet condescended to give no reasons for toleration, Puritan politicians were exasperated, while Puritan divines and pamphleteers wrote enthusiastic and wearisome tracts to prove that England was pledged to the continental form of Protestantism. High church clergymen were rewarded by royal favor for preaching and writing that the king was above the law and could be neither criticized nor resisted. And the Puritans answered by combining their resistance to ecclesiastical innovations with a passionate claim for the supremacy of Parliament over the royal power. Thus the religious and the political opposition were merged in one. The struggle that ensued became a battle for sovereignty, that is, for the supreme and final power in the state. Both parties claimed divine sanction for their religious program, and each wished the state to enforce it. The king and a majority of the churchmen combined to resist the claims of the Parliament and the Puritans. The Parliament and the Puritans combined to dispute the king's right to lay down the law in church and state. Thus the opposition, though it claimed to be national, was really inspired by that personal spirit which claimed the right to think for itself in matters political as well as in matters religious. Men began to teach that the real duty of a government was to get at the mind of the nation and carry out its will, rather than to dictate what was to be done and believed. Now the question of sovereignty was one on which it was useless to appeal to former practice, for there were enough precedents in church and state to justify both parties. Each accused the other of innovation or departure from custom, and each claimed the conservative position so dear to Englishmen. The king said that the claims of Parliament to a share in the sovereign power were unheard of, as indeed they were, if Tudor times were the test. Archbishop Laud thought the Puritan idea of a strict observance of the Sabbath was unheard of, which until very recent years it certainly was. On the other hand, Parliament considered that the king's claim to be above the law was unheard of, and on medieval precedents this too was true. The Puritans urged that the ceremonies they were told to observe were innovations, and for many years this also was true. The solution of the religious dispute was a gradual extension of freedom in thought and action, but for this neither party was as yet prepared. The solution of the political dispute was a gradual change in the form of government, from one in which the king commanded and the nation chafed, into one in which the government was responsible to Parliament, while Parliament was responsible to the electors. The struggle wore on till it ended in war, which did not bring a settlement of the question. Not till the end of the century was toleration begun in practice, and the law finally placed above the king. But by the time of William III, the cabinet responsible to Parliament, which carries on a national government in accordance with national wishes, was not far distant. When England had learnt that the majority of men in a civilized nation cannot be permanently excluded from a share in its government, the goal, to which the struggles of the 17th century had been pointed, was reached. It is our own fault today if we cannot trust each other in religious questions and trust our elected government in national questions. End of chapter 1. Chapter 2 of King and Parliament by George Henry Wakeling. The Reign of James I, 1603 to 1625. James Stuart, the successor of Elizabeth on the English throne, was the son of the famous Mary Queen of Scots. He had been king in Scotland almost from his birth. On his accession to the crown of the Triple Kingdom, henceforth called Great Britain and Ireland, he was 37 years old. His position in Scotland had been one of great difficulty, largely owing to the Presbyterian clergy whose constant officious interference with him had grafted in his mind a firm belief in the merits of an episcopal church dependent upon the crown. James was acute in his own limited way, learned and good-humored, but his character was fatally marred by conceit, obstinacy, and indecision. His uncouth manners and ungainly person rendered absurd his claim to be considered a supernaturally gifted king, the British Solomon, as he loved to be called. An honest belief in his own abilities and good intentions is always a source of weakness to a man who has little power of work and less appreciation of difficulties. James was and remained without a policy, though a policy was imperatively necessary for one who had to deal with the two great questions which Elizabeth had left unsolved, the question of sovereignty of the state, and the question of toleration in the church. The first 10 years of his reign are marked by constant little failures, which are hardly retrieved by the absence of any great mistakes. The king failed to keep in touch with his first parliament, which lasted from 1604 to 1610, as completely as he showed himself unable to solve the increasing religious difficulties caused by the rise of the Puritans. In Ireland and Scotland, attempts at a statesmanlike policy were thwarted by the royal obstinacy. But in foreign matters, where in after days James was apt to flounder more than in domestic, he was kept from serious harm by the wisdom of his first minister, Robert Cecil, Earl of Salisbury. The attitude of the Parliament toward the king was from the beginning ominous of troubles to come. The Commons stated in the form of apology, 1604, that their privileges were their right, not derived, as James thought, from the royal grace. This strong language was occasioned by his attack upon the right of the lower house to decide disputed elections. Nor did the leader spare hints that the dangers of Elizabeth's reign had kept the parliamentary demands more moderate than they were likely to be in future. The king merely replied that they should use their liberty with more modesty. The complete union of England with Scotland was one of James's dearest projects, but the English were jealous of Scots, and the matter was finally dropped because there was no agreement as to how it should be managed. Parliament wished to have a share in effecting it by legally naturalizing Scotchmen. This the king thought was accomplished by the mere fact of his accession. An appeal to the judges produced the decision that a child born in Scotland since 1603 was not an alien, and further than this the king, who had the best intentions in the matter, was unable to go. In religion, which was likely to prove the greatest crux of all, there were three parties. Those Orthodox Anglicans who conformed to the prayer book and the church system of Elizabeth, the obstinate few who remained true to Roman Catholicism, and the Puritans, who had been persecuted by Elizabeth, but hoped for better times under the new regime. The Roman Catholics were menaced by many laws passed in the late reign, which made the exercise of their religion high treason. They were also liable to fines for not attending their parish churches. The former are called the penal laws, the later recusancy fines. James did not share the bitter feeling which had prompted these laws and would fain have put an end to all religious quarrels. A noble aim, but not a practical one, in an age when the popes still looked upon England as probably reclaimable to the dominion of the Roman See. Parliament spoke the voice of the majority of Englishmen when it demanded the enforcement of these cruel laws. Their attitude was strengthened by the wild attempt of some fanatical papists to sweep away king and commons alike by the horrible gunpowder treason. In 1605, these eager spirits, their chiefs were Catesby, Winter, Fawkes, and Digsby, formed the gunpowder plot. The Houses of Parliament were to be blown up during a sitting at which the king and the Prince of Wales were present by means of gunpowder placed in the cellars beneath. It was discovered through a letter in which one of the conspirators endeavored to hint to his friend the danger of attending Parliament on November 5th. After the execution of Guy Fawkes and others, persecution fell more stringently on the Catholics, for the nation suspected that they had all been implicated in the plot and wished to exterminate the whole sect. Meantime, the Puritans were far from satisfied. In the millenary petition presented to the king very shortly after his arrival in England, 1603, they had asked for some alterations in the ceremonies to which all ministers had to conform. James arranged a conference between bishops and Puritan divines at Hampton Court, but there were great difficulties in the way of making the church wide enough to contain these men who wished to modify the 39 Articles and to grant all presbyters a share in the episcopal power. The high churchmen opposed all such changes. James himself had a wholesome dread of the introduction of the Scottish system. The only result of the conference was that some canons were drawn up in 1604, binding clergy and laity still more strictly to the prayer book. For the time, the parliamentary protests against this attitude of church and crown were in vain. But when James showed a disposition to side strongly with church against state in matters of law, and proposed to settle the vexed question of the jurisdiction of church courts by hearing cases himself, he was led into a serious quarrel with Chief Justice Cook. The lawyer plainly told him that the royal power was official rather than personal, and that the law was above it. Such a doctrine was anything but agreeable to one who held with divine hereditary right. Taxation was another point on which James was soon at issue with his subjects. The king's income was not sufficient for the needs of government as well as those of an extravagant court, whose officials made money at the nation's expense. Parliament was not liberal to a king with whom they so seldom agreed, and James, relying on precedents in the late reign, took upon himself to increase the import duties without consulting Parliament. Such impositions had been made illegal in Edward III's reign, but the judges decided in the case of Bate, 1606, that the king could increase or vary such taxes by his prerogative or royal power alone. This was the first of a long series of cases during the century in which the king appealed to the bench for a confirmation of his rights. James's first parliament closed its 7 years' duration with a quarrel over another financial difficulty. The Great Contract was a scheme by which the crown should renounce the antiquated feudal payments due from land in return for a fixed annual sum. This finally failed, for the commons required, as a preliminary, satisfaction about impositions and church courts. It was of little use for men like Bacon to hope that king and parliament would work together for reform and progress. Each was in fact beginning to claim for itself a discretionary power to act somewhat beyond the existing law. The Tudor plan of doing what was necessary was losing credit in the face of the further question of what was right, and it is certain that a man like James put a great strain on the idea that kings govern because they know best. Meanwhile, Ireland had its own set of difficulties and problems. The Irish Rebellion of 1598 had been pitilessly crushed, and in 1604 Sir A. Chichester undertook the government of Ireland. There were two chief difficulties, land and religion. The native Irish looked on Protestantism as a foreign creed forced on them against their will. The Lord Deputy tried conciliatory measures and hoped to educate the Irish in the change of faith. But the Irish Parliament of 1613 proved as intractable as the English, and James foolishly recalled Chichester, of whose moderate policy he had not approved. The agrarian difficulty which Chichester had proposed to solve by abolishing the ancient Irish custom, by which the whole tribe held the tribal lands in common tenure, and making the natives free tenants, led to a wholesale eviction of the latter and the colonization of Ulster by English and Scotch settlers. On the continent, the government had inherited from Elizabeth a policy of war with Spain, but as Spain was no longer dangerous, James and Cecil wisely made peace in 1604. There was, however, a feeling in England that something should be done for the Netherlands, that is, the countries we now call Belgium and Holland. The northern or Dutch provinces had recently thrown off the yoke of Spain, while the southern or Belgian had, by cruel persecutions, been kept back in their servitude. James was, in fact, induced in 1609 to guarantee on behalf of the northern provinces a treaty by which they obtained a 12 years' truce from Philip III, but he refused to be dragged into a war against Spain in their interest. He also allied himself with Henry IV of France and with the Protestant princes in Germany, marrying his daughter Elizabeth to the Protestant Elector Frederick of the Palatinate. Such was the policy of Cecil, who died in 1612. With his death following on that of Henry IV and of James's hopeful son, Prince Henry, the chances of a successful foreign policy came to an end. From 1612 to 1619, James fell from bad to worse. Finding that Parliament could not be molded to his will, he came to rely on favorites who molded him to theirs. He opened an intrigue with Spain and became a tool in the hands of its quick-witted ambassador, Sarmiento, Count of Gondomar. He adopted Bacon's fatal theory that the judges should be lions under the throne, that is, the king's tools, and dismissed the chief justice who objected to be made the exponent of this experiment in natural history. He trampled on the Scottish Church, quarreled with the Dutch, and so lost touch with his people that when a national question arose in the last period of his reign, he was unable to avoid disaster. A Scotchman named Robert Carr, upon whom James lavished titles and favors, was now his chief adviser. He had been made Viscount Rochester and shortly became Earl of Somerset. The Spanish party at court and the Spanish ambassador Sarmiento used this favorite to further their policy. The alliance with France had failed after the three deaths before mentioned, and the efforts of Spain were now directed to replace it by a closer friendship with the court of Madrid. The Spaniards had a delusion that Protestantism was merely an English fad, which might be removed with patience and care. James's own idea was expressed in the words Beati Pacifici. He loved to dream of himself as the peacemaking arbiter of a docile Europe. But he failed to see that Spain liked peace for other reasons, that she did not want England to help the Dutch, and was only trying to win toleration for the Catholics, fondly dreaming of the complete conversion of England to crown her castle in the air. The financial needs of the government caused a parliament to be summoned in 1614, but the new assembly refused to supply the royal needs unless it could obtain some satisfaction about impositions, which had been largely increased since the case of Bate. The Spanish party suggested that a marriage of Prince Charles, now heir to the English throne, with the wealthy Infanta Maria, daughter of Philip III, would settle James's debts, and the king, relying on the kindly feelings of the Spanish ambassador, dissolved Parliament after 2 months. Digby, afterwards Earl of Bristol, was entrusted with negotiations of a vague character for the Spanish match. He was able and honest, too honest to be on a level with the Spanish diplomatists. The obstinacy and consequent dissolution of Parliament soon caused another return to arbitrary taxation by royal mandate. This took the form of a benevolence or free gift, but the gift was in truth so little free that a man named Oliver St. John was prosecuted in the Star Chamber for refusing to contribute. This court, the king's favorite engine, was extremely powerful because exempt from the ordinary rules of judicial procedure. It had been very effectual in suppressing disorder in Tudor times, and was now composed of the members of the Privy Council, who were thus able to punish those who resisted the royal authority. It was practically the ministry sitting...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.